Hello everyone, myself Gayatri Bajpayee. In this video, I am going to tell you Johnson-Cook damage parameters. In the previous video, I have told you Johnson-Cook plasticity model, Johnson-Cook parameter up to the plasticity limit. There we were focused on the flow stress. What is the coupled effect of strain rate and temperature in the flow stress? Here I am focusing the equivalent strain at failure due to the coupled effect of stress diaxiality, strain rate and the temperature. We are using same experimental setup, same UTM machine and any high strain rate machine. We can get these data points and according to these data points, we can find these parameters. Here in this video, whatever the pictures and data points I have used, that is from the published paper only. So okay, let's start to find the damage parameter. Johnson-Cook damage parameters. So here this is the giving the equivalent strain at failure. F shows the failure. This is the equivalent strain. And it is also giving the coupled effect of stress diaxiality. This is called stress diaxiality. Okay, stress diaxiality factor. Diaxiality factor. Okay, and this is the strain rate effect and this one is for the temperature effect. So it gives the coupled effect of the stress diaxiality, which is for the giving the effect of void formation in the material. Void formation in the material due to the stress. So suppose this is your bar and you are pulling it out in this direction. So some voids are generated like this. So the stress diaxiality will give how these voids are generating. So that effect is comes through the stress diaxiality factor, and the second bracket is showing the strain rate effect and third bracket for the temperature effect. So EF is what? Equivalent strain at failure. And D1 to D5, these all are the damage parameter. In the Johnson-Cook plasticity model, we were calling A, B, N, C and M. They are having that name like yield strength at reference condition. B is calling strain hardening constant, N is strain hardening coefficient, thermal softening coefficient, and like this, they are having the name strengthening coefficient for the strain rate. But here we call that D1 to D5 all are called the damage parameters. And this is sigma star, this is called triaxiality factor. This is nothing but equals to sigma M upon sigma equivalent. I mean sigma mean upon sigma equivalent. Mean is nothing but hydrostatic stresses. And this is the equivalent. The ratio of these two, mean and equivalent, is called the triaxiality factor. And then next is EP star. Dash star, that is called strain rate ratio. So strain rate at plasticity and reference strain rate. So plastic strain rate and reference strain rate. So the ratio of these two is called EP dot dash star. And this is D5 is the parameter, damage parameter, and T star, that is nothing but T minus T reference upon TM minus T reference. T reference is reference temperature, TM is the melting temperature, and T is the deformation temperature. So okay, start with the first bracket. The first term is EF equals to D1 plus D2 exponential of D3 into sigma star. As we are taking the Johnson-Cook plasticity model, similarly this first bracket we have taken. As I have told you in Johnson-Cook plasticity model, that parameter, they always I have to take the first bracket as a reference bracket for finding the strain rate coefficient, for finding the temperature coefficient. Always this first bracket is required. Here also in the similar way we will do. But there, what is the difference there? That is, we were having sigma flow stress. That flow stress equals to A plus B epsilon N, like that. That was the first bracket. So here A was the yield strength of material. Yield strength of material at the reference condition. So there we know the one parameter. We know one parameter by finding the stress strain graph. If we doing the stress strain graph like this, so this is a stress versus strain graph is there. Then we are finding the yield point. So yield point we know. So always we were knowing the one parameter. But here we don't know any parameter. All the three parameters are unknown. So here it is easy to find, like that I have done, that sigma F minus A. equals to b times epsilon of n. So I have to find the b parameter. So I have taken the ln in both the sides. So it is simply the straight line type of the curve we have found, and the slope of that line, it is the b, that parameter. But here it is not like that. Here d1, d2, d3, all the parameters are unknown. So first we are focusing this, what is called this stress triangularity factor. This is nothing but sigma m upon sigma equivalent, because due to this stress triangularity we can get how this void formation in the material. So this is what, this is equal sigma m upon sigma equivalent. Sigma m is nothing but mean stress, that is if you know the principal stresses. So sigma 1 plus sigma 2 plus sigma 3 by 3. That is the mean stress. Mean stress equals to sigma 1 plus sigma 2 plus sigma 3 by 3. And equivalent stress is what? That is under root of 1 by 2 of sigma 1 square minus sigma 2 square plus sigma 2 square. These things we can derive also. This equivalent stress and what is the mean stress. So this is called the principal plane equation. And I1, I2, I3. These are the invariants. If you don't know how to find this type of the equation, what is the derivation of this equation, I can make separate video for that. You can ask for the comment box. Okay, if we know this principal stress equation, so these are the I1, I2, I3. These are the invariants, and the value of the I1, I2, I3 is this. Sigma x plus sigma y plus sigma z equals to I1, and I2 is what and I3 is what. So, okay. Suppose we are having, and I have taken one example. That example, suppose your specimen is round bar specimen, and you have used this specimen in the UTM machine like this, and you are putting the tension. So generally the specimens are like this. Suppose some threads are there, and the specimen is like this, and like this, and some threads are there, and we can hold to this threads, and this is in the UTM machine. Sometime it is in tension, sometime it is in compression, and at a low strain rate. So it is the quasi-static process, and due to this tension some voids are generating. So okay, so this time if I am taking, this is the y-axis, okay, this is the x-axis, this is the y-axis, and suppose this is z-axis. So only the force in a y direction, no x direction, z direction, or no shear force is there. So you are having only the stress in y direction. So sigma y value you are having. For this type of the round bar specimen, you are using only uniaxial tension force then. So okay. So if I will put this value in this equation, suppose this is equation number 1. So I1 is what? I1 is only sigma y. I2 is what? I2 will be 0. I3 is what? I3 will be 0. Because all the forces are 0. Only sigma y is there. So only one invariant you have find. Now put this value into equation 1. So it will be sigma cube minus of sigma y sigma square equals to 0. Now we can take sigma square as a common. So it will be sigma y sigma minus sigma y, that is equals to 0. So here sigma square equals to 0. So we can say that sigma 1 equals to 0 and sigma 2 equals, and sigma 3 will be how much? Sigma 3 will be sigma y by taking this as a 0. So okay, you are having only one principal strain, that is sigma 3, which is equals to sigma y for this particular condition. So you are having the stress, whatever stress you are having, that is sigma y. So you can put sigma 3 equals to y. So now you have to find the stress triaxiality. Stress triaxiality is what? Sigma 1 plus sigma 2 plus sigma 3 by 3, that is nothing but sigma m, that is equals to sigma m, and stress triaxiality equals to sigma m divided by sigma equivalent. So sigma m equals to is what? Sigma y by 3. Okay, and what is sigma equivalent? That we know, under root of 1 by 2 of sigma 1 minus sigma 2 square, so this is 0, plus sigma 2 minus sigma 3 square, so that is minus of sigma 3 and square, so it will be plus, so it is sigma y square, plus sigma 3 minus sigma 1 square, so this is also sigma 3 square, so it will be 2 sigma 3 square, sigma y, here it will be sigma y, sigma 3 is equals to sigma 5, so it can be written as 1 by 2 of 2 times of sigma y square. So this 2 cancel out and it will be sigma y. So what will be the stress triaxiality? So stress triaxiality equals to, that is sigma y by 3, or division in the division sigma equivalent, that is sigma y. So this is equal, sigma y is cancel out. So this is equals to 1 by 3. So if you are having a round bar and you are putting it in a UTM machine and one uniaxial tensile or compressive force is acting. Here it is, I am talking about the tensile force, because if it is a compressive force, then sigma 3 will be minus of sigma y, because now this sigma y that will be negative. So we will put here I1 equals to, this is 0, sigma x is 0, minus of sigma y, and this will be equals to 0 plus 0. So this will be sigma y equals minus of sigma y. So here it will be minus of sigma y, and in bottom side it is square, so there is no negative, and top side it will be minus of sigma y. Then for the compression, if it is not a tension, for a compression type of force is acting, then it will be minus of 1 by 3. So but if you are having some notch here like this, so at that time, what will be the stress triaxiality? That time stress triaxiality is different. That time we cannot use simply by using this formula. So some other model is required. That is given. So if you are having the notch in the bar, that is this type of the bar. This is the plain bar without any notch. And this is the notch bar. This is notch is given. There notch is given like this. And this is the plain bar. Okay, here the simple example, they have taken one round bar, this is the machine where it is applying the tension force, and this is the notch, different notch, that is circumferential radius of that notch, and what is the notch diameter, that is different a by r. So for this type of condition, sigma star equals to 1 by 3 if it is in tension, and if it is in compression, then it is minus 1 by 3. That we can prove very easily. But if it is in notch, so for that the Bridgman analytical model has given. So that is equals to 1 by 3 plus of ln of 1 plus a naught by 2 r naught. What is the a naught? A naught is the radius of the initial cross section area of the notch specimen. So suppose your specimen is like this, so whatever the cross section, this notch cross section area, so that radius, so if I am taking the cross section, so suppose this is the cross section, so whatever the radius of this cross section, that is called a naught. Initial is why? Because before applying any stress in the any axis, so at that time what is the radius of the cross section area of notch specimen, that is called a naught, this a naught value. And what is the r naught? R naught is the radius of the specimen notch. So what is the specimen radius? This is also having some radius, so that is called r naught. So if they have taken a naught upon 2 r naught, so 1 by 3 plus ln of 1 plus a naught upon 2 r naught, that is the formula. This is the given by Bridgman analytical model. So for the tension 1 by 3, for the notch bar this formula, if shear is there then it is 0, this is given the pure shear, and for the compression that is minus 1 by 3, and for the plastic plane strain that we can also prove, that is minus of root 3 by 3, and again for the notch bar compression, that is only negative sign. These are same, only the sign is different. Okay. So according to this, we can find different triaxiality, stress triaxiality, and at that condition, at that stress triaxiality, we can find the failure strain or fracture strain or equivalent strain at failure. One paper, I have found this type of the graph, and the previous one, whatever I have shown you, there I can got the different graph. But the graph was like this. I mean, if you see the graph was, this is failure strain and it was stress triaxiality. So they were having the data points up to like this. So if you are getting this type of data points, okay, then it was showing like a straight line. But we are having the equation of this exponential type of equation. I mean, equation should be, exponential equation will be like this. Okay, so if we are having the data points which is fit in this step of the equation, then it will be very easy to fit the curve, because here D1, D2, D3, all three points we don't know. Previously in the Johnson's Cook plasticity model, A, B and we know the A value. So B and N we can get very easily through the linear straight line by using, and whatever the slope is there, that was B. So simply I used that values in the Excel sheet and simply I got the B parameter. But here D1, D2, D3, all the parameters we don't know. So here we have to fit this curve. People have found this D1, D2, D3 parameter by using this Levenberg algorithm. And I also have used one gradient descent algorithm for finding this D1, D2, D3 parameters. Suppose you are having some data points and this the mathematical equation, then we can fit this data point to that mathematical equation and we can find this D1, D2, D3 parameters. So one more important thing I want to share you for fitting this type of the mathematical equation, at least some data points are required. Just like this is the separate graph, separate paper. In that I have seen they have taken approximately 15 data points. So it was required 15 experiment. I mean 15 specimens are required, because this one is for 0.3, 1 by 3. So 1 by 3 is nothing but 0.33 values are there. So these are the triaxiality factors and this is the fracture strain. So that they have found, and this type of the graph they have found. So then we can fit this type of the data point to this equation. But if you are having the data points up to this, like this, then it is difficult to fit this type of the data point to this equation. Then if you are doing the optimization method or any algorithm, then it is quite difficult to fit. But if you are doing, if you are planning to do some experiment or you have done already some experiments and your data points is like this, then actually I personally feel like that it is very difficult to fit this type of the equation here, then error is very high. Then optimization method, whatever optimization method, whatever algorithm we are using, that is very difficult to fit these data points into this equation. So if you are having the sufficient data points and the data points if smoothly fitting like this, so we can get, because triaxiality we don't know about the fracture strain, that we find through the experiments only. We are using any UTM machine and at very low strain rate we are using different specimen, as I have shown you at the NOST, different A by R ratio, and accordingly the finding the fracture strain. So the fracture strain we don't know, but at least we can get one approximation that the graph should be like this. So they have used one unnosed round bar, then nosed round bar. So like that we can get the parameter. So they have used 15 specimens. So similarly, if you are doing number of experiments, number of specimen we are using, then it will be the very good curve will fit and we can get D1, D2, D3 value very nice. Paper. In this paper, they have found these parameters. So I have mapped these points and this x value, I mean sigma star, it means stress triaxiality factor values, and the fracture strain value find through this graph. And I have also used one algorithm and try to find this D1, D2, D3 parameters. Actually, I already know this D1, D2, D3 because in the paper it was given. So I was trying to optimize in that way that we can get the same D1, D2, D3 values. But I have seen if you are having this type of number of parameters, number of data points, then it will be very good to fit this type of the mathematical equation. I have also done one calculation for D1, D2, D3 parameters by using gradient descent algorithm. So if I compare this D1, D2, D3 parameters with the papers, in the paper whatever parameters has given. So for this paper, in which the 15 data points were given, in this paper if I am comparing, then it was approximately matching. So D1 is 0.025 according to the paper, and what calculation I have done according to this 0.023, and here in 16.19, 13.25, minus 14.8, and I have got minus 14.03. They have the error is 5.98 and I have got the error 4.92. What calculation I have done. So, and in the second paper if I matched, in which not many data points were given, only these many data points were were there, and it is very old paper, and in that if I am comparing, so the D1, D2, D3 values, so in the my calculation it is coming 0.01, from the paper it is 0.04, like that, but it is also approximate matching, and what error I have got, that was 0.0027. And if I have done for one more paper, I have used this paper for finding the D4 and D5 parameter, and in this paper when I have compared with these parameters, so it was approximately very much matching and the error is same. And in this paper they have used Levenberg algorithm and I have used gradient descent algorithm. Actually this also based on this gradient descent algorithm. And why this D3 value is coming positive in the paper and negative in my calculation, because what formula I have used D3 is positive, and in the paper they have used the formula minus of D3, so that's why his value is coming positive and my value is coming negative. So whatever calculation I have done for finding this D1, D2, D3 parameters, the source code is available in GitHub repository. I will copy the link of this source code in the description box. And if you are having any difficulty to calculate this D1, D2, D3 parameters, then you can ask through the comment box. I will make another video to explain this source code, how I have done the calculation by using this gradient descent algorithm. Now the second term. For finding the this D4 parameters. So now D1, D2, D3, these values are given in this paper. So I have used the D1, D2, D3 values from this paper and the sigma star. So one most important thing they have told, that stress diagonality factor always take the maximum one for getting as a reference, because here we are using as a reference, this bracket as a reference bracket. So stress diagonality factor for as a reference stress diagonality factor, we are taking always maximum one. So he has tried for 1.33, 0.96, 0.61, but he has taken 1.33 stress diagonality. Q is showing as a stress diagonality factor. So they have taken stress diagonality 1.33, that is calibrated reference stress diagonality data. Okay, so if I am using 1.33 and even D2, D3 values from this paper, suppose these all values are write as a A, capital A. Okay, so EF equals to, that is the equals to A times 1 plus D4 ln of epsilon P star. Okay, so if I will divide this EF here, A here, the EF by A equals to 1 plus D4 times ln of epsilon P star. Okay, so we can write it like this, EF by A minus of 1 equals to D4 times ln of epsilon P star. So okay, so suppose this will be a y-axis and this is in your x-axis, and whatever the slope will be, that is the D4 value. So here again is the linear one, we can easily find through the Excel sheet, and this complete value is called the normalized failure strain here in this graph. But for a better understanding, I have reverse calculation and have find the EF value, I mean failure strain, what will be the failure strain that I have find by using this D1, D2, D3 and sigma star all values. So whatever the EF value will be there, because whenever you will do the experiment, you will find this EF value for different strain rate. For different strain rate, what will be the failure strain? So if you are having this type of the failure strain values and you have to find the D4 parameters, so how can we find that? We will see through the Excel sheet. I have done the reverse calculation and find the equivalent strain at failure. Okay, and their strain rate. So these strain rate were there 0.01, 0.5, 500, 1000 and 1800. And they have taken this 0.5 as a reference strain. Generally, we are taking the reference strain rate, whatever the minimum one. But here they have taken the 0.5 as a reference strain. So because that is not hard and fast, but we are taking the reference strain rate, whatever is having in a quasi-static process, which is having the low strain rate. Okay, so they have taken 0.5 as a reference strain rate. So that is 0.5. So we have to find ln of the ratio of this the strain rate, whatever different strain rate, we have done the experiments and the reference strain rate. So this divided by this and of ln of this ratio. So the ln of the ratio of the strain rate versus reference strain rate. So this is the value and drag it here. D1, D2, D3 and sigma star, that value we can find from the first bracket. Okay, and sigma star, the maximum stress diaxiality factor we have taken, which we will get from the NOST specimen. And A is what? A is nothing but the first bracket we have solved, and that I have written as a A. So first bracket is what? D1 plus D2 exponential of D3 times of stress diaxiality. So that is your first bracket that I have solved and written as a A that I have solved. So now this is the failure strain, and failure strain you have found. So EF upon A minus 1, this is the value. So this will be in the y axis, and this is ln of a strain rate, this will be in x axis. So I made the graph between this x axis versus y axis. So this is the graph. So okay, if you want to make the graph the x axis versus y axis, so simply we can choose that data points and then make the graph. Okay, so this type of the points we have found, and we can set the trend line here, type linear one only, and so this is equation will be okay. And here I can formulate the trend line. So this was the slope. Slope was coming 0.08, that we can see. Okay, which I have already done, 0.08. But in the paper they have given 0.029. So this is very much important thing. Whatever data points, whatever parameters we are finding through the experiments like A, B, N, C, M, and here D1, D2, D3, D4 parameters, and we are using these parameters in the simulation, so it may possible that we are not getting same type of failure strain as in the experiment. So we have to require some calibration also. So according to that calibration, they have done some calibration and they have found D4 values 0.029. Similarly for D1, D2, D3 value also they have done some calibration, and generally it is required. So it is not 1-to-1. I mean, whatever we are finding the A, B and C through the experiment by using this type of the calculations, it may possible you are using this parameter in the simulation, and whatever the failure plastic strain and whatever the stress you are finding, that stress you are not finding in actual condition in experiments. So we have to keep these things in our mind, and it means we have to do after also some calculation. In the third term, previously for finding the Johnson's group plasticity model, like M term, for finding the M term we have taken first bracket and third bracket, and for finding the C parameter we have taken first bracket and second bracket. But here in this paper they have taken all the brackets for finding the D5 parameters. So they are having lots of variables. They have taken different stress diaxiality and different strain rate. So for this type of material they have used, so for different diaxiality stress, as they have told in the second term, for finding the D4 parameter they have told the Q equals to 1.33, I mean stress diaxiality is 1.33, I mean maximum one, then they are getting the more accurate value. So again, if they have used 1.33, then they will get more accurate value. So they have used different strain rate. For different temperature, they have found the normalized failure strain. So if we are using this one, this stress diaxiality is Q equals to 1.33, this red one. So in the red one, they have seen for different strain rate. And this is the homologous temperature. What is called the homologous temperature? T star, as I have told earlier, the T minus TR divided by TM minus TR. So here they have taken the temperature T1 23 degree centigrade, T2 23 degree centigrade, T3 466 degree centigrade, T4 is 706 degree centigrade, and reference temperature they have taken 23 degree centigrade, because if you see at 23, I mean first one data, it is showing the zero. Homologous temperature is zero, because if you put T minus TR, both are the same 23, 23, then it will become zero value. So the homologous temperature will be zero at that condition, and the melting temperature of this material 4130, that is 1520 degree centigrade, that they have taken, and accordingly they have calculated this homologous temperature. So for different homologous temperature, for different strain rate, this is the 500 strain rate, then 1000, then 1800. 1000 and 1800 strain rate, mostly they are overlap to each other, that not much difference. Here also you can see not much difference in rate, as they have increasing the temperature, the strain, this failure strain is going down. Strain rate, your failure strain is increasing. But as you are increasing the temperature, then this failure strain is decreasing, and up to this limit, and after that it is again increasing. So you can see all these data points for different triaxiality stress, this is looking like as a curve type of, not a straight line, but they have fit linearly because this is the equation like a linear type of equation. So they have mentioned these things in the paper, that this linear fitting is not perfect for this type of the data points. So okay, now we will see how they have calculated. So what is the normalized failure strain? For the normalized failure strain, they have taken this data and this data both. So suppose this is A value, this is B value, already they have found D1, D2, D3 value and D4 value, and sigma star and this star for different triaxiality stress, and for different strain rate, they will vary accordingly. So okay, so if you are having EF equals to A into B times of 1 plus D5 T star. So T star is homologous temperature. So if you are doing this failure strain divided by A into B minus 1. Okay, so this will be equals to D5 times T star. So whatever the slope will be, so this is the your y-axis and this is your x-axis. So whatever the slope, that will give you D5 value. And what is the y-axis? Y-axis is normalized failure strain. So whatever they have written normalized, normalized means they have already done this calculation. So this is y. So this is nothing but your failure strain, whatever strain was coming at that time, divided by A into B value minus of 1. So that is your normalized failure strain. So this is now very simple, if you know the things. So very simply, this is the linear fitting, and you can find this D5 value by using the Excel sheet. So okay, I will show you how to find through the Excel sheet. We have taken this type of the temperature, this is the homologous temperature, and for different strain rate, this is for 500 strain rate, this is for 1000, and this is for 1500. So for different strain rate, what will be the normalized failure strain is coming. So these are the values. If I plot the graph between homologous temperature and this failure strain for different strain rate, so this is for the blue one for 500, and for 1001 this orange one, and then yellow one for the 1500 strain rate. And then I have put the trend line for separate values. I mean for 500 strain rate, this is the trend line, that is the 0.36 D5 value is coming. And if I am putting 1000 strain rate, so it is coming 0.76. and if I am putting the trend line for the strain rate 1500, at that time D5 value is coming 0.67. and if I am combining all these points, so if I am combining, I mean I have taken all the points, I mean I just copied this one here to here, and then this one is copying from here to in between, in below that. Okay, so if I am taking all the datas at that time, if I fit the trend line, then it is coming D5 value is 0.6, and as they have mentioned in the paper, that was 0.71. like this. So it mostly match with this value. So in this paper we can see, if you are having the lots of data and then you are finding different D5 values, so we can use this value and we can say which one is the best one. So we have to calibrate after that. So directly whatever we are finding, that are because lots of factor affecting these experiments inside that body. The damage is not only for one purpose, there are lots of purposes are there. So these parameters we are using the simulation, so we have to know that which one is the best fit. So accordingly we have to do some calibration. So in all the papers I have seen, in this paper he has mentioned very clearly each and everything, and most of the papers they have shown that they have calibrated. In this video, whatever data points and pictures were there, that is through the published paper, and I will give you the title of all the papers in the description box. So okay, if you feel like this video is useful for you, so please like and subscribe my video. And if you are having any doubts, so please ask me through the comment box, and thank you very much for listening.